Sri Jayalakhani, an excellent communicator of Hinduism in Britain and director of the Hindu Academy, the Vivekananda Centre in London. Over the last 15 years, Sri Lakhani has given talks on Hinduism to thousands of youngsters at English schools, colleges, and universities. If you wish to get a glimpse of the modern, dynamic face of Hinduism, then do not miss this series of talks.
Today we're hearing from Mr. Lakhani, who was born in Kenya. He came to the UK when he was 15, where he studied physics at Imperial University, specialising in quantum mechanics. He takes many roles representing Hinduism in the UK, as well as playing a key role in interfaith relations, including running the Hindu Academy. He's the Director of Education at the Hindu Council, through which he introduced Hinduism to the GCSE and A-level syllabus for religious studies. He's also the first ever tutor, a Hindu tutor, to be appointed at Eton College, where he is a Hindu chaplain. He writes articles in newspapers and makes TV appearances on the news, commenting on many issues, especially cultural pluralism, which you all remember from his legendary assemblies. So I'd like for you to give him a warm welcome and show your appreciation to our guest, Jayalakhani.
Physics. So what is this physics telling us? At the heart of physics, not in the periphery, not some side effect that we have not explained, at the heart of physics, the most exciting thing at the heart of physics, and you heard this word before many times, is called quantum. Now you see, youngsters love Harry Potter and magic. If you want real magic, study the quantum. It'll make your hair stand up or fall out. It is the most exciting thing physical sciences have ever come across. And some of the discoveries of quantum or quantum mechanics are non-negotiable. Normally physics doesn't use language like that. That's everything is negotiable. We keep moving on and learning better things, deeper things. But this aspect of physics sits in the middle of physics and is challenging the rest of the physicists in every field of human thinking. So what is it? This is what we are discovering at the heart of matter, at the heart of this physical of most physical sciences. It's telling us, these are the words of, let me first of all crack a little bit of humor, otherwise it becomes too heavy-handed this afternoon. This quantum phenomena has got three fathers. Now, if you got any child with three fathers, that child will be weird. So the quantum phenomena starts with two, three fathers. As we are already expecting trouble here. Now, what is this quantum phenomena? What are the names of the fathers? Let me give you the names. Werner Heisenberg, Niels Bohr, and Erwin Schrödinger. These are the three fathers of quantum mechanics. And this quantum chap, little chap called Quantum, also had a very nice uncle who helped give him birth. But that uncle suddenly turned round, like in a soap opera, and become vindictive and vicious and try to run down the poor little Quantum every time he tried to cross the street. He was waiting in his car to run him down, this horrible uncle who helped give birth to the Quantum and yet wanted to run him down at every corner. And you may be surprised to hear the name of this lovely uncle, this villainous uncle. His name is Einstein. He had great difficulty with the Quantum. He said, "I hate this Quantum fellow, I'll run him down. I wish I had never thought of it." And this, he kept fighting the quantum phenomena, he kept failing, kept losing against the other three fathers who were protecting the little quantum. "Come here, my boy. Nobody can run you down." This is the story of the quantum. Now, you see, Niels Bohr says, if you come across the quantum phenomena and you don't start to feel dizzy, that means you've not understood it. But the converse is not true. So if you are playing rugby in the Watford Grammar grounds outside and you start feeling dizzy, go and see the nurse, the physician. That doesn't mean you understood quantum. But why is it making people go dizzy? This is why it's making them go dizzy. This is at the heart of physical science. It says at the heart of physical science, we discover this quantum, and we can say now that the underpinning to this reality, see this reality, chairs, table, floor, me, you, underpinning this reality in front of us, underpinning the primary building block of this reality is in front of you, the primary, not the secondary. we can say now with certainty is not matter, it is non-material. You say non-material, we just did everything in terms of matter and its attributes. You say there is no matter underpinning this reality? Oh yes, there is no matter, guaranteed. The thing that is underpinning matter, which appears as matter even your atoms and electrons, is dramatically non-material, guaranteed not to be material. It is very fluid, it defies everything that you would ascribe to a matter, to matter. It is non-material, guaranteed. This is a dramatic statement to come out of physics. That's in the physical of most physical thing is not material. The matter has disappeared. What about our materialistic philosophy? Of course, still hanging in the sky now. Matter has disappeared, underpinning this reality. The underpinning to this reality, says the physics, is a phenomena we call quantum. We can give you mathematical explanation regarding how to play with it. We can give you all the mathematical articulation to use it. But if you tell me, ask me what it is, then I have no vocabulary for it. This is the language of physics. See the honesty of this particular science. It doesn't want to fob off. It says not matter. That's the only thing we can say, guaranteed not to be matter. What it is, don't ask. What is coming through is that when you dig deeper into the nature of reality and try and grasp reality, take a pinch of reality, we're discovering underpinning this reality is essentially spirit. It is spirit that manifests, makes itself appear as matter, because more clearly visible as living things and the clearest vision of the spirit is humanity. See, right to the heart, from the science lobby, comes right from the heart of it, underpinning to this reality. Don't reduce us to matter and its epiphenomena, because matter is secondary. I can't build my castle on matter because it's a secondary phenomenon, it's an appearance. I'd rather go to the primary phenomena. Primary phenomena is quantum. Dramatically unusual and nothing to do with matter. Dislikes the idea of matter and its attributes. You may say, okay, Mr. Lacan, you come from physics and you are showing us, if you like, some cracks at the heart of physics, which is telling physics is not physical anymore. It is metaphysical, or if you like, spiritual. Fair enough, it gives us a bit of a buzz. Doesn't give us enough satisfaction. Let's go a little bit deeper. Some of you might decide to study neuroscience at universities, it's a wonderful thing to explore, because it is now going to look at how what you call yourself, this reality you see in front of you, your brain, etc., how are they all linked? And my own mentor, the professor under which I did my master's, is called Roger Penrose, has done a lot of work on this field. It is to see what is the heart of neuroscience? Not the fact that, you know, we can tell you exactly which neuron is firing when you are dreaming by using CAT scan. That's baby stuff, that's kindergarten. The central problem, look, the central, not the periphery of neuroscience, of life sciences, is this idea of what is consciousness? What the heck is this? And every attempt to try and write it off, explain it away, is, if you like, a very poor attempt to generate vocabulary to explain away things which they can't explain. At the heart of neuroscience, you check up with Susan Greenfield, one of the top neuroscientists in the country. She will say the hard problem of neuroscience is what is consciousness, what is the seat of consciousness, which part of the brain, which slice of the brain produces it, what is it? She keeps challenging the brain scientists, the brain surgeons, saying, tell me which experiment I can do to find, trace the source of consciousness in your brain. Tell me and I will do that experiment on some poor chap. But show me one experiment. They say, we don't know, Susan, seems to be everywhere and nowhere. You say, this everywhere and nowhere? That's consciousness? Oh no, it can't be that straightforward. It's just too poetic. Let me give an example. See the power of metaphors. Watch out, metaphors are tricky, but use them if possible, whenever you can present some subtle idea. The brain scientists continue to fight this idea of consciousness being something non-material, appearing in this material world in variety of ways. For example, at one session they told me, Jay, look, you know, stop being so airy-fairy about this consciousness. It is nothing but brain phenomena. It is just the activity of your brain. There is nothing more to consciousness. Don't you see, when you go to sleep, it disappears, your brain, your neurons stop firing, and you go to, that's gone. And suppose, you know, you don't agree with us, we'll come with a hammer and thump you on your head, and consciousness will go. We told you it's a brain phenomena, nothing but your brain creating a buzz, electrical and chemical activities, firing away, creating a fuzz, we call consciousness, that's nothing more, Jay. We can give you anesthetic and you'll go, oh, you disappear, there's no conscious. See, we told you, we can interfere with your brain and switch off, there's no consciousness anymore. It seems to be a plausible way to explain consciousness as a brain phenomena, and yet it doesn't. I'll just show you, I'll just counter this example. Suppose a child walks into this room and he discovers a dimmer switch. He starts playing with the dimmer switch. He turns it one way, the light comes on. He turns it the other way, the light goes off. And the child will be definitely convinced that the switch is producing that. You can't blame him. And yet, we know that the switch doesn't produce that. The switch is a mere conduit of consciousness, of electricity. It doesn't produce electricity. In the same way, this Hindu is saying, consciousness is not something produced by the brain. Brain is the switch, if you like, the conduit of consciousness. You can interfere with the brain and stop the flow of consciousness, but that doesn't mean that you really found the seat of consciousness. You can easily hit the switch with a hammer and the lights will go off. That doesn't mean you sorted the issue out. Switch does not produce that. It is just a conduit, a switch through which it flows through. When I give this example to Susan Greenfield, she said, yeah, I agree with that. That's a marvelous metaphor. But that in a way allows us to realize that consciousness is much more than meets our eye. It is not a material phenomena. There's something much more dramatic about consciousness, which seems to be, if you like, the underpinning. Because look, without consciousness, we don't have access to reality. What is this phenomena that we possess that allows us to, you know, interact with reality? It's a dramatic phenomena. So you try and explain it away in terms of the part of things you are conscious about, this matter, seems outlandish. And yet we still do that. This is the paradigm of materialism, trying to reduce everything to matter and its epiphenomena. So I just touched on two aspects and just showed you at the physical level, you find suddenly at the heart of physics, things which are saying matter, the time of matter and its attributes over, we need to look at reality in a deeper light. And the deeper light does not agree with this kind of simplistic expression of matter and its attributes, substance and its attributes. It's time to give it up. Neuroscience is telling us the thing that is so endearing about all of us here, I hope it is true, is consciousness. And I hope you're not dozed off on me today, and you are conscious about what I'm saying. This phenomenon that is looking at me through your eyes now, this consciousness, is something you thought is a casual word we use to describe the way we live or something. No. This is, if you like, your spiritual underpinning shining through your eyes, looking out through your eyes, your underpinning as a spirit. So what I'm suggesting this to is to you is this. At this level, I won't go any deeper, but there are deeper aspects. The ideas of trying to relate to the idea of consciousness and quantum is so crucial, because quantum and consciousness are linked. You see, one is physical science, other is a life science, a neuroscience. How can they be linked? They are linked at a deeper level. And this is where, if you like, the story continues. Science is struggling to explain away consciousness, explain away the quantum phenomena. And yet at the deeper level, the unification lies by invoking ideas which are not necessarily physical, but metaphysical. Not just scientific, but spiritual. This is where science and religion meet and shake hands. Because at the deeper level, this is what the Hindu tradition teaches. See if you can agree with this. It says that this thing that we are searching for in the name of an almighty God as a theos is essentially the underpinning to this reality as in ourselves. We try and grab this idea. This is a very subtle idea. We try and make a grab for this idea using our human framework. So we generate this idea of an infinite God, all-powerful, all-knowing, almighty, but in a way we are grappling with the spiritual underpinning that we possess. We are trying to articulate that. And this is how the prophets and the religions sprang up, to try and articulate this discovery about the spiritual underpinning to ourselves as well as this greater reality. So this is how the religion sprang up, trying to relate to this deeper spiritual dimension to our being. And this is what sciences are discovering. Look, never underestimate the power and the integrity of science. They are very one-pointed. And the discoveries that they are coming forward with are not something that you pass them by, but you need to explore them in deeper level and not this kind of simplistic, materialistic level. This is where we stand at the moment. So the journey that started off as challenging the idea of a theos also continues by challenging the idea of matter as the epiphenomena that explain this world, as if you like, the underpinning to this world. Let me just digress a little bit more. Even in life sciences, say biological science, I'm not going to neuroscience, just talking about biological sciences, it has always been very difficult to define a living thing. You may think that should be the easiest thing. You study biology, here we have been taught how to define a living thing. And you use various ploys to define a living thing. You'll see how difficult it is to even define a living thing in biological sciences. It's not that straightforward. Because, you know, the every attempt you make to try and articulate a living thing, you say, well, living things are little tiddly things, they become big things, like, you know, little baby becoming big human, that's a living thing. I say, oh, well, you see those crystals in your chemistry laboratory? They are little tiddly ones and they become big ones. That means that's living? You say, oh, no, that's not crystals, not that. We know. Living things are those things that produce little baby ones. They reproduce. That's the definition. Sounds good. And of course, I'll point at the mule and say, look at this mule, he can't reproduce. That means he's dead. He said, no, he's alive, he's kicking. Oh dear, things are struggling, we are struggling. Oh, no, of course, we live in the IT world. The way we define a living thing is so easy. Living things are those things that can process information. You love the word information. Living things are those things that can process information. That's how we define living things. Sounds good, doesn't it? And of course, I'll immediately pull out your laptop and say, look, see this little chap here? He can process information a billion times more faster than all of you put together. Now, what does it say about definition? The computer is alive, you lot are dead. See, this is tricky now. Every attempt to articulate the idea of a living thing falls by the wayside. One biologist, I think you may like to look up, is Fitzroy Capra. And his definition of a living thing I like very much is this. He says, living things are those, and this is, I think it's his example. He says, suppose you saw a piece of stone in front of you, are in a kind of kicking mood, and you went near the piece of stone and you said, okay, let me give it a kick, practicing my rugby skills, and you give it a kick. And you are a physicist, you can work out the trajectory of that rock, exactly where it will go, how far it will go, you can work it out to the nearest millimeter, you are so good. Suppose you're walking by, and you saw a little dog sleeping. Now look, I'm a mild-mannered Hindu, not advocating violence against animals, but suddenly you wanted to check your rugby skills. And you went near the dog and said, okay, let's go for it. And suppose you gave it a kick, one thing you can be quite certain about is you won't be able to work out its trajectory. He will come for your leg. See why I'm cracking humor, because I'm trying to show you there's much more to us than meets the eye. This unpredictability about a living thing, this uniqueness about a living thing, of interacting with its surrounding in a selective manner, this is the way they define living thing, in a way defines the spiritual underpinning. This is how Hinduism defines a living thing. See how well you like it, and see how well it relates to modern biology. It says, the way we define a living thing is that thing that stands up against natural, if you like, physical forces. It is always not in compliance with the physical world and the physical forces you see in front of you. It is in defiance of it. See, when you say little bacteria, what is it doing? It's fighting against natural forces. If it stops fighting, the natural force will tear it apart. What is the sign of a living thing? You interact with your surrounding in a selective manner. You see, this is how you define a living thing. You are not in compliance. You don't like to be buffeted by nature. You don't like the forces of nature to buffet you. You like to stand up against the forces of nature, against the physical reality, and if you like, to show yourself as something in defiance of it, not in compliance with it. This is how you define a living thing. And you all go, yeah, that's what I am all about. I hate being pushed around. I like to stand on my feet and stand up against all the forces around me. This is what defines a living thing. This is, if you like, your spiritual underpinning showing its true colors. It is not in compliance with the physical world, it's in defiance of it. See, the spirit, not matter, as your underpinning shows up in this particular manner. So I'm going to conclude by saying, what we are searching for in the highest heaven, in the seventh heaven, is this invisible fellow called God. And we are bowing down, trying to relate to it by becoming like him, in a way was a ploy for us to rediscover our essential nature as the spirit, not as matter, but as spirit. Perfect cue. So I'm going to finish now and open myself up for questions. You're welcome to ask pointed questions and any question that arise. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Please raise your hand, you will be selected, and then please state your name and form and ask a question. So, who would like to ask Mr. Lakhani a question?
Timothy Hillel, opposite me. You say that we have God as an interpretation of the spiritual force in a human form, and yet that is what all of our religions are based on. Are you therefore suggesting that perhaps religions as they currently exist aren't something that should be followed as they are, and therefore perhaps it's religion that needs a step and not silence?
Okay. I would say, this is a very good question, I'll repeat it for the sake of the camera. You're saying that does it mean that religions have to evolve, if you like, move forward? I would say yes, of course. You see, the thing is this is one of the criticisms of world religions. The scientific enterprise is prepared to continue to evolve, taking into account changing circumstances and new discoveries. It will continue to evolve. This shows a living enterprise. Religions, unfortunately, have a habit of becoming stuck in a rut, saying that this was written in my book, here I wave my book, my prophet discovered this and he said this, and this is not negotiable, it's set in stone. When you do that, you immediately offend a lot of people who say, look, provided you are prepared to evolve and say, look, this was a suitable ploy for a particular period of time in history, for a particular set of people. But provided you stick to the underpinning, what they are talking about, rather than the externals, and are prepared to evolve, you are going to become outdated, and your sell-by date will be gone. And this is what most religions are finding, whether you're Hindu or a Christian. You find that some of these antiquated ideas do not relate to you anymore. I mean, look, I'm a Hindu, but I'm a non-theistic Hindu. I like the idea of God not as a super personality that I go and, you know, bow down to in the temple. I see my God in living beings. I say, ah, that's my God shining out through those eyes. Spiritual humanist. So if you like, this ability to evolve with the changing times and recognizing spirituality in a different guise, not just in a religious guise, is crucial. But I'm not only challenging religions, or if you like, this monotheistic ideas, I'm also challenging materialism. In fact, my challenge is challenging the paradigm of matter. Because this has done tremendous damage. It's not religion that has done so much damage. The idea that we are just nothing more than a lump of carbon that got wound up through accidents of evolution, nothing more to you, is highly denigrating to humanity. So if a humanist says, this is what I promote, I say, you destroyed my dignity. You're calling me a lump of carbon? I can flush it down the loo. It's worthless. There's something more to me than that, just if like matter. And this is how the paradigm of materialism is cracking up through modern neuroscience, through modern physical sciences, and that I'm pushing it very hard. This paradigm of materialism needs to be demolished now in this century. Some more questions? Then all the answers. Ask me a question.
Mr. Lakhani, do you believe that in order for people to get more in touch with their spirituality, in order to get more in touch with God per se, that we should destroy the organized part of religion, of organized religion? So going to church on a regular basis, being forced to learn about the Bible and religious books and religious education, those sort of things.
So very you see, you can straight away see that he's got tremendous resonance with the audience here. Majority of youngsters I interact with, and I do ask them, majority, whether they're Hindu or Christian, majority, my experience is now suggesting in schools, especially at this age group, are either atheistic or agnostic. They rather prefer that approach rather than a theistic approach. Because this idea of being fixated on a theos, and if like organized religion with a very kind of very, you know, severe kind of narrow vision about the world, is no longer acceptable, majority are moved away. So the thing is this, the way we are in a way showing our dislike of these organized religions is by voting with our feet. We have stopped going to temples and churches. This is not only for Christians, this is true for Hindus too. The Hindu youth are not able to relate to all this multitude of gods and goddesses and cracking coconuts. So they are moving away from it too, because they want to make sense of this. Look, do not underestimate the power of the youngsters to think for themselves. They are trying to relate to reality in a sense that will make sense to them. And the best filter they have to understand reality is this thing called rationality, common sense. So unless things kind of sit well in their commons with their common sense, they are not going to swallow it. They are going to reject it. This is why religions are shuddering. The attendance is in church. I mean, look, on Sunday morning, you just pass by a supermarket. It's full to the brim, and the trolleys are full to the brim. And you pass near a church or a temple, they are almost, deserted. So what's happening? We are already showing our dislike of this idea of organized religions. And it is something that is visible in every society in modern times. Very good question. Any more final questions before we finish the session? Thank you. Very good question. This is a marvelous question. You see, the underpinning to this reality, I keep using the word spiritual without actually, trying to define it or classify it or to try and encapsulate it. We need to encapsulate it. I'm going to go a little bit higher. I didn't want to, but I will, because I think it's such a lovely question. You see, when the Hindus were questioned that you talk, because this is esoteric Hindu, I'm not making anything up. This is esoteric Hinduism without reference to a god. When they were said, you are talking of a spiritual underpinning to this reality, what are the nearest words you can give us to get a handle on it? Because you need to give a handle, as you see, you need some proof, something to get your hands on. What's the handle you can give on this idea of spirituality? The two words that came out of Hindu tradition, they are very thrilling words. They said the nearest language, the nearest vocabulary we have to try and explain what this spirituality is all about is two words, asti, bhati in Sanskrit, which means A-C-E-T, existence itself, and consciousness itself. They are not even two separate entities rolled into one. This is the underpinning to reality. You may say, well, it sounds nice and airy-fairy, but still, what do you mean existence? What do you mean by consciousness? Let me show you. You not studied quantum mechanics, but if you study quantum mechanics, the whole mathematical formalism is explained through this something called the psi function that defines reality. This is called Schrodinger's equation. Now, the psi function is very thrilling, very exciting. If you ask a physicist, how do you give it physical interpretation? Because very airy-fairy mathematical phenomena. What is the physical interpretation of this psi phenomena, the psi function that gives you a description of reality? He'll tell you, Jay, the only way I can explain this is this. If you squared it with itself, then at best it gives you probability of existence. This is how it's defined. So again, the word is not matter. Probability of existence is the definition of this quantum phenomena. Now, let me just show you how it relates to the idea of Hinduism. It defines the idea of this reality is existence itself. The most, if you like, the primary building block is existence, but existence on its own is so homogeneous, you can never experience it. You can never interact with it. You cannot classify it. If there's a variation in existence, you say, how can you variation? If there's a variation, that can be visible. There's no physical, if you like, parallel that I can say, oh, this is quantum, because then it's no longer quantum, it's become matter, it becomes the appearance. The phenomena is deliberately going to stay invisible, not because it's weak and fuzzy and misty. I hate the idea of misty, like that, okay, mystical. It's not things of the sort, because it is underpinning, it is necessary to be that versatile, it will not be captured except through this kind of very loose language of existence and consciousness. If you try and say, look, if I ask you, define consciousness, you will give me anything but consciousness. Because you say, my thinking process. You see, you are conscious about your thinking process, but that is not consciousness. The physical world I see. You are conscious of the physical world, but not about consciousness itself. It will remain crucially invisible. You are conscious about things, but not about consciousness itself. This is the underpinning, the spirit underpinning to your and to my being. Spirit is the underpinning. And thankfully, it is so versatile, you can never capture it in a jar, otherwise it becomes matter. We are lost. Richard Dawkins wins then. Thank you, my friends.